man. How you doing?
I am good. How are you?
I'm pretty good.
You happy to be at home for a little while?
Yeah, man. It feels great to be at home. It's wonderful.
Hey, well, we had kind of like a little bit of an outline for the interview. Kind of wanted to start off with some generic questions and then kind of get into some of your projects of late.
Uh-huh.
So you're obviously a huge fan of not only playing the guitar, but you seem to have a real appreciation for the instrument itself. We were wondering if you have a preferred guitar or a guitar that's out there that you want to play at some point in the future.
Oh, yeah, man. It's so funny you should mention that. I've always liked Stratocasters, and my whole thing about, putting humbuckers in a Stratocaster is kind of like, trying to split the difference between a Fender and a Gibson. Because Strats and Tellys always have single coil pickups, which is, real bright sounding, and it's hard to get them to really sing real pretty, But it's an old saying that real men play single coils because, you have to do it. I mean, there's nothing helping you. With humbuckers, it's a little more forgiving. This is guitar geek stuff,
I got it.
But the point is that, I've always, for years I've been putting Gibson-type pickups in a Fender-type instrument. And the reason for that is basically the scale length of a Fender is longer. The neck is longer. And what that does is it puts the frets further apart from each other. Now, some people like that, because it gives you, when you get way up high on the neck where the high notes are, they're far apart from each other compared to a Gibson, which the frets are tightly packed in there because the neck is shorter. So you still have a shorter neck with the same amount of frets. And so what happens is they get closer together, and it makes it tougher to play, but way up there on the high notes. But the good thing about it is it makes it easier to bend notes, because you don't have to push the string as far when you're bending one up into another one. And but the Fenders make you work a little harder. You got to stretch further. You got, your longer scale length. So when you bend a note, you have to bend it further to hit the pitch you're going for. And it wrenches your hand a little bit more, a little bit harder to play.
So you like the challenge?
Well, I don't know if I consider it harder to play. It just seems tailor-made, like some people say that, but on a Gibson, I just can't play it as well for some reason. It just seemed to be built for Fenders.
Well,
don't really know why.
I didn't mean to cut you off, but we noticed Dwayne's guitar at the show the other night.
Oh, yeah. Bruce was playing Dwayne's guitar, yeah.
I was wondering if you guys were fighting over who got to play it.
No, definitely not, no. I've played it before. It's great. It's a great instrument, but, it's... My instruments are kind of set up, with certain little small modifications that make it easier for me to play. And, and his guitar is kind of hard to play, although it's an awesome guitar. Awesome. I mean, it's like one of the only Les Pauls I've ever played that I wish it was mine. Or at least one like it,
Definitely. Yeah, I was wondering at the show. I thought Bruce had it the whole time. I was like, is he not sharing?
No, I'm sure he would have if I wanted to,
Gotcha.
I was just playing a little, you mentioned that thing about, guitars I want to play in the future. I've just been on a Telecaster binge, after years of playing Strats, and, the tremolo on the Strat is something that can help you be more lyrical. You can play more vocal-like things. But Tele is like, think about it, it's the first solid body electric guitar ever created, I think. And, it's relatively unchanged. I mean, sure, people have done modifications to them, but, it's just such a basic instrument, and there's something about it that's drawn me close to it again. And, I don't know if I use it a lot with Panic. I use it some, but for what I'm doing right now, it's the only guitar I've been playing since the ARU show. It's just that's the only... I mean, a couple of different ones, but they're still Telecasters. Yeah.
Well, it definitely sounded great.
Thank you.
Another question was kind of more along the lines of who your musical influences have been over the years, and, you know, if that's changed.
Well, it changes all the time because, you know, you're hanging around different people. I mean, you know, sure, your influences are the people you grew up listening to. You know, for me, that would be, you know, all the rock and roll from my time period when I was a kid. My brother's music, you know, older than me. You know, but when I was growing up, it was Jimi Hendrix, and I was listening to his records, you know. Allman Brothers, Jimi Hendrix, Led Zeppelin, the Beatles, you know, all the stuff they call classic rock right now. And so I love that stuff. That's what got me interested in playing. But then later, you know, of course, it became, you know, more jazz-oriented things. At first, it was just instrumental rock, you know, like the Dixie Dregs or Mahavishnu Orchestra, which, you know, Return to Forever. That stuff is not typically, it's not jazz, you know, but people call it jazz because it doesn't have lyrics, you know, no singer. But then that led me back to real jazz, you know, like, you know, traditional jazz and all the offshoots of it, you know, swing, bebop. And so, of course, Cannonball Adderley, John Coltrane, the saxophone players made a big impression on me, Wayne Shorter, you know, and all Miles Davis's children, basically. and all the people that played with him and then went on to form their own bands, which would, you know, John McLaughlin would be one of those people. So would Chick Corea. So would Keith Jarrett. So would, you know, many, many others. Joe Zawinul from Weather Report. So, yeah, all that music really impacted me a lot, you know. And but then, you know, you also get influenced by the people you're playing with. You know, like when I played with Phil Lesh, he was a tremendous influence on me. Playing in Panic. I mean, the guys in the band are an influence on you. You know, you kind of learn each other's language and things about each other to, you know, bleed off on you, you know, which is a good thing.
Definitely. Well, if you had the opportunity...
I got to mention Derek because, you know, man, I mean, yeah, he's younger than me. Yeah, he's one of my best friends in the world, but he's a tremendous influence on me. I mean, he doesn't mean to be. It's just, you know, I can't help it. When I hear him play, you know, those slide lines, it's like a gospel singer. And hearing him was a tremendous impact on me, and it sent me back to listening to gospel music, R&B, not just Duane Allman and Elmore James, but them too, of course. But, you know, I mean, man, you know, him and all his influences were a huge impact on me. All the Indian music he listens to, the stuff he's turned me on to, so I'd be crazy if I didn't mention that.
We were fortunate enough to speak with Derek a week or two ago when they were in town for the Chastain show, and I had kind of mentioned y'all's relationship in that discussion, and he kind of alluded to the fact that it's almost like a father-son, little brother, big brother type thing, and was talking about how when y'all are on stage together, you kind of have your own language going on, and it's kind of hard to not kind of fall into that every time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, well, we both were influenced tremendously by Bruce Hampton, you know, so I was playing in Bruce's band, and he was a 12-year-old kid, and then he came to open a show for us, and of course, we had been told by, you know, other people, wait till you hear this kid, you're not going to believe it, but, you know, you can hear that, but we... You know, you hear that a lot. Oh, yeah, we got this blues prodigy, you know. Yeah, right, blues prodigy, you know, and you're thinking to yourself, that's an oxymoron, you know. You got to be old to play the blues, you know. You got to have suffered. You got to have, you know what I mean. And this kid...
Worn down by life a little bit before you can really feel it, you know.
Yeah, well, that's what you think until you hear this 12-year-old kid sound like he's an 80-year-old man who... you know, was in the cotton fields for 50 years, you know. I mean, it was just unbelievable, you know. He sounded like an old soul, you know. And, I mean, you know, he had the same kind of thing in his playing that, you know, Son House and Elmore James and, you know, just these ancient people have, you know. And, of course, he just knocked us all on our asses. And, but, you know, he hung around us a lot when he was young, you know, from the time he was 12 till the present, you know. So Bruce was a tremendous influence on him, too. and me. So, and then we, you know, there'd be periods where you could hear, I could hear him sometimes playing things like he might have picked up from me. But, you know, it shifts back and forth all the time. Like right now, if someone said, who's more influenced, Derek by you or you by Derek, I'd have to say me by Derek, you know, and I'd have to. I'd be lying if I didn't, you know. So
that's a huge compliment. But
yeah, he's like a brother to me, you know, he is.
Have you had an opportunity to hear their latest album, the Tedeschi Trucks, Revelator?
Sure. Oh, yeah.
Just outstanding.
Absolutely outstanding. But not surprising, you know. I mean, I knew what they were planning to do. I knew they were planning to get a big band and kind of put Susan at the forefront of it with her incredible voice. And, you take that slide sound that he has and put it with her voice and then, you know, build everything else around it with superlative musicians like Kofi and O'Teal and JJ and Falcon and incredible horn players and, I mean, who am I forgetting? God, it's such a big band, but it's just, oh, Mike Madison's compliments to it. I mean, it's incredible. Yeah. Wonderful.
It certainly is.
Yeah.
But kind of a question about, your musical career. When you were playing the Atlanta music scene, you know, back in the time of the Brandy House and we're just getting to know Colonel Bruce and Jeff Mosier.
It was way before the Brandy House.
I'm sure, yeah, even before then.
Just to let you know, yeah. Go ahead.
Did you ever foresee your career having the success that it's had in the last 10 or so years and playing with all the amazing musicians that you've had the opportunity to meet with?
No, man. I didn't ever, you know, expect or, you know, see that coming or anything. But, you know, different people have different ideas of what success is. To me, you know, success is just being able to play music every day and make a living playing music. And that doesn't mean, you know, being a rock star or anything silly like that. I mean, we were very happy, you know, even back in like 93 when we were making, you know, $15,000 a year or whatever it was, you know. You know, it just, I felt like we were a success then on some level just because I got to play my guitar every day and I got to do it, you know, I got to be with a group of people that that was totally driven and, you know, playing with Bruce every day. Bruce doesn't tell you what to do. He just gives you this incredible outlet and, you know, he turns you on to music that, you know, that he looks for purity and he looks for essence and he looks for good intention in the music, you know? And so if you're up there using music as a vehicle to try to get laid or something silly like that, well, then that's not going to fly, you know? You know, and it was great to be around people that were thinking like that, you know? And then, of course, you know, yeah, I would have never seen everything that happened after that, no. I would have never imagined in a million years. But I've been extremely lucky, and, I mean, luck is such a big part of it, you know?
Yeah, I think it's a blessing to be able to do what you love for a living and to be able to support a family off that and, you know.
Absolutely, and, you know, anything past that is just, you know, a gift, you know. But it's a gift, period, you know. But it's just, man, if you're able to, you know, make a good living playing music, geez, man, I mean, you got to be super thankful. And you can never forget, you know, how many great musicians there are out there that are not able to make a living playing music for whatever reason, you know. So that's what tells me, you know, there's too many virtuoso players and not even virtuoso sometimes, just really great players in all styles of music. There's millions of them out there that can't get a break. You know what I mean? So that tells me that it's got to be more than just how well you play or how not well you play. It's got to be more than that. It's destiny. It's luck. It's karma. You know, it's the intention you put out. You know, you know what I'm trying to say. Like I know people who are just fabulous musicians, but for whatever reason, you know, they can't, you know, get a gig and hold on to a gig. And, you know, it's just so, like, baffling to me. So it makes you very, very grateful, you know, for what you've got. I've been blessed beyond, I just can't even put it into words, you know.
Well, I think there are a lot of fans out there that feel blessed to have you playing for us on a regular basis. So.
Well, man, thank you so much. I'm so incredibly grateful. I mean, I really am. And, you know, man, just it seems like the older I get, the more I want to play. You know, like, went to Japan with Panic. And, you know, first we had that summer tour, and it was long. And then we had the Japan gig coming up. And during the time off between then, all I did was play like 6 hours a day. And then we went to Japan, and then I came back, and I had like a week before the ARU gig. So I played 6 hours a day, you know, and then we had the ARU gig. And now that that's behind me, I've got about a month off, you know. So I came home, and I looked at Carolyn, and I was like, I don't have to be anywhere. I was like, I don't have to do anything. And then I said, well, I'm going to go play. And I played for 6 hours a day. It's not, I'm not trying to, you know, say I play 6 hours a day every day. I'm just saying I'm just in a spot right now where I'm just extremely motivated and grateful to have this incredible opportunity to play music on a regular basis. And I swear, you know, it never stops. I mean, it's absolutely infinite, and I'm so inspired right now that, you know, that's all I want to do is play all day, every day. And then she goes to sleep at night, and then I come back down and start playing again. It's like, you know, it's just fun. It's fun right now, and I'm trying to write for a upcoming album project. So, you know, it's a good time to be trying to write, you know. So,
well, I'll follow your segue on that. I did see that you posted something on Facebook about working on a new album. Is that going to be another Me Hearing Band project? Or?
Well, I'm sure I didn't post anything on Facebook because I've never seen it, but. I mean, it's probably my guys, like Shovik and those guys, and taking care of that for me. Well, you know, he did an album with me about 4 years ago, I guess, 2008, maybe it was 3 years ago. Anyway, same guy, you know, wants to do another. I mean, I would have done another album by now, man, but it's just that we've been so busy, you know, between, it's just been one of the, you know, we did a little bit of touring with my band, I played with Lenny White for a little bit, you know, and then, you know, of course, Panic's been busy. So, you know, there's been no time at all to write, you know. I mean, little things will come to me in the dressing room on the road and stuff like that, but I haven't been able to sit in the basement and work on writing for a long time. And so I'm excited about, we're going to do another album, but there's no specific date that it's coming out. I don't even have the music yet. I have pieces, you know, sketches, and I'm trying to whittle it down to make compositions out of it, you know. That's what I'm doing right now.
Well, with Panic taking a break, it sounds like, for most of 2012,
right.
You might get some time to focus on that.
Yes, absolutely, and that's the number one priority after Panic starts taking some time off, which would be, I don't know when it's going to be, sometime next year, but, you know, that's when I've got to make that record. And of course, you know, they want you to tour too, you know, and I don't know. There's so many wonderful opportunities out there right now. You know, during that time off, there's any number of things I could do. We could play some more with ARU, could do my record and maybe play some more with my friends, Jeff Sipe and Neil Fountain and Matt Slocum, could do that, you know, could, maybe do, there's talk about an instructional DVD of some kind that they've been, you know, people have been pulling at me about something like that for a long time. But, you know, to me, it's like all the same information that everybody uses. It's like, it'd be just like telling someone, this is a wheel. It's round and it rolls. You know what I mean? But they're trying to make me see that, no, it's your take on, the people want to know your take, you know, and I'm like, really? I'm sorry. So I just start laughing. So I'm trying to arrange, you know, if I do something like that, hopefully it won't just be the same old crap that everybody already knows. And I've, you know, started outlining, if I do something like that, what I would do first and, you know, the order that it would come in and that kind of stuff. But so that's kind of what the plans are for next year. You know,
I'm sure there's some unique tips that you've picked up over the years that would benefit guitar players out there?
Yeah, hopefully. And hopefully, you know, it would be more than just about guitar, and it would be, you know, just music, because that's really the goal anyway. And, you know, we all love the guitar because the guitar is an incredible instrument, because it's one of the few instruments out there that is capable of, you know, sounding kind of like a human voice, but at the same time, you know, you can play more than one note at a time. You can play chords, you know, and like saxophones can't play chords. And I mean, not typically. I mean, some guys can split the reed and get harmonics, you know, more than one note at a time. But in general, you know, the guitar is a great instrument because it can play chords and it can play single notes, you know, and you can emulate two people playing at the same time. Some guys can emulate three people playing at the same time, you know, like Chet Atkins and people like that. It's just in the hands of different people. It's just an incredible instrument. So we're all drawn to it, you know. And but at the core, I hope it's just about music, because that's, Bruce used to say that all the time, guitar or music. And I would always say music, and he would go, "You're lying." You know, we're talking 20 years ago. You know, because, you know, what his question was when he said that was, okay, what's more important to you, music or guitar? And, of course, I said music, you know. Guitar is just an instrument. But, you know, he didn't believe me. You know.
I can definitely.
Guitar players, I'm sorry, man. The reason I'm going on and on about this is because guitar players, more than anyone else, tend to be about their instrument instead of about music. That's why I felt it was so important to tell you that. So,
I got you. Well, as a music photographer, I tend to have a preference to taking pictures of guitarists. So,
mm-hmm.
I can kind of understand.
Yeah, because you know, did you ever see that sketch on Dave Chappelle where
about the drums and the guitar?
Yes, wasn't that incredible?
Yeah, that was hilarious.
So funny. And John Mayer was with him, and, you know, and they went to a, you know, like a board meeting at a bunch of rich white people in a board meeting, and they started playing the guitar, and the girls started taking their clothes off and dancing on the table. Remember that?
Yeah, it was classic.
Oh, that was just, you know, and then the rest of it where they went into the Latina barbershop and they were telling them to shut up. You know, that was just how different cultures are attracted to different instruments. It's just hilarious. It's true. It's really true.
Well, to kind of reel things back in a little bit, I want to talk to you a little bit about the Georgia Theater.
Yeah.
And, you know, clearly, you know, a monumental icon, especially to the Southern music scene.
Absolutely, yeah.
What were your thoughts about the theater and what it was like playing there again?
I was thrilled to do it. Wanted to do it, and was very glad that they rebuilt it, and had some great times there, you know, dating all the way back to the early 90s, late 80s, and, you know, it's such a special place in my heart. It's where I, you know, we used to open for Panic there, you know, when I was playing with Bruce Hampton's band. We made a live album there in 1991. It didn't come out till 92. No, wait, we made it in 90, but it came out in 91, sorry. But we were opening for Panic when we made our live album. And see, we were both on the same record label. And Bruce's friend, Billy Bob Thornton, directed Panic's video from... And, you know, at the time, Billy wasn't a big star yet, you know. But we knew him through Bruce, you know. Bruce knows so many people that are cool, you know. But, yeah, so there's just an awful lot to remember fondly about the Georgia Theater. And so glad they rebuilt it. And to get the chance to play there again with some of my favorite people on this earth, it was just special, you know. And the only thing missing was Matt Mundy. I just wish he was there, you know. I wish he would have been there. The old mandolin player from the old Aquarium Rescue Unit, you know.
Definitely. Well, it was definitely obvious that everybody on stage was having a blast and just casting smiles at each other every chance they could. And
oh, yeah.
And the goofiness that ensues from that. I was going to ask, you know, after not ARU not playing for several years, what kind of inspired that reunion? Was it just the opportunity?
The Georgia Theater called somebody, And I got a phone call saying that they were, you know, that I knew they had rebuilt it and they had were working on rebuilding it. And but somebody said something like, yeah, they want ARU to get back together and play during the grand opening week. And of course, all of us wanted to do it. We all love each other. We don't not play together because we don't want to. It's just everybody's so busy. And I don't know why it's taken so many years for us to get back together and play, but we had so much fun. We'll probably do it again. You know, there's no actual, you know, plans concrete, but all of us enjoyed it, and all of us want to do it again, you know.
Yeah, we're wondering, you know, if maybe some of those older members that you had mentioned, like Jeff Mosier or Mundy or Mobutu or Kofi might get in if y'all do some more ARU shows.
Well, we hope so. God, I mean, we would love to. I mean, you know, I know that the group was together before I was in it. I mean, Jeff Mosier was in it before I was, and so was Charlie Williams, the deacon, you know, Deacon Williams. You know, he was in it before I was, too. And I love all those people, you know. But when we all talked, we thought, you know, there's so many great people to sit in, but you know, this is the first gig we've played in a long time, and we all felt like, let's just keep it a five-piece for tonight, you know. And so probably what you're saying will happen, you know, and that the next time hopefully we'll have some guests, you know, some people sitting in that were in the band a long time ago, you know, like Jeff Mosier. I mean, he's incredible. And I would love to play with him again. And Ike Stubblefield, and he wasn't in the band, but he's just an incredible organ player. And who else? Oh, my God. You know, Charlie Williams, you know, Matt Mundy would be on the top of that list, too, you know, if he would come out and play. We'd love to play with him.
Well, judging on how well the crowd received the show, I think there's definitely a desire to see more. So
I was laughing so hard looking out there at all those young people seeing Bruce. You know, it was just hilarious, you know. You know, like a lot of those people probably never saw the band when it was actually a band, you know. And it was just real funny to us, you know.
Well, like, I think that says something about, you know, the music. You know, it's transcendent, you know, across a generation.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, just like 20 years ago, Widespread Panic was really key in helping us get out there and play in different places and, you know, spreading the word. They were always real cool to us and spreading the word, you know, every way they could and taking us on the road with them. Same thing with Fish, too. Fish used to take us opening for them, too. And so did Dave Matthews and Blues Traveler. You know, all those bands were really, really helpful to us, especially Panic. I mean, you know, they just, you know, truly helped us. And, you know, and I think, you know, through the years, I guess some of these people who may be fans of those other bands, you know, have heard, I don't know, maybe they've heard tapes or something, you know, from 1992 and stuff like that, you know, but they've never seen the band. So maybe that's why the turnout was good, you know.
Well, I also don't think it hurts when there's, you know, a room full of gifted musicians that, you know, are going to be playing for you. So even if they weren't as familiar with all the material, you know, maybe they're going to see a Colonel Bruce and an O'Teal Burbage and a Jimmy Herring and a Jeff Sipe, and let's see those guys rock out.
Well, thank you, man. I just feel completely, you know, honored to be in the company of those amazing players, you know, and people, you know, that I've known for so long. And Matt Slocum being there was huge, you know. I mean, he's an incredible player and incredible person. You know, he was in O'Teal's band, O'Teal and the Peacemakers. That's where I first heard him. And when I heard him, I was like, man, this dude can really play, you know. And then I got to know him, and I was like, wow, what an easygoing dude, you know. And so he came out and played some shows with us.
Yeah, he was doing the Jimmy Herring band for a while, right?
Yeah. I called him and asked him if he was free, and luckily he was. And he lives in Birmingham. O'Teal's got a whole constituency of great Birmingham musicians that were playing with him. One of them is the drummer in the Zac Brown Band, you know, Chris Fryer. And then Mark Kimbrell on guitar, incredible guitar player. And then Matt Slocum, you know. And that's where those guys were in O'Teal's band.
I think it's a beautiful thing, you know, and all these different bands have all kind of worked with each other at one point or another, and you can just mm-hmm. call up your buddy and say, hey, you know, come make it out to the show tonight.
Right.
But
everybody's so busy, you know. we were lucky to be able to do it, you know, that all of us were off at a time when this could happen, you know.
The stars aligned.
Yeah. Great. It was fun. I mean, we laughed and had fun, and I mean, it was just a ton of fun.
Well, I wanted to talk about widespread a little bit. From the photos I saw, it looked like there was a pretty warm welcome in Japan. And
yeah.
Ask you what that greeting was like and what the overall, they're calling it the Japanic experience now.
Well, let me think. Well, when we got off the plane, you know, there was a handful of fans there to greet us, you know, when we got down to get the check package at the carousel, you know. And they were so sweet, you know, they were so wonderful. I think I've met a couple of them at Red Rocks or at the airport in the States when they travel, you know, they get on a plane and come to the States to see us. And, you know, some of them. And so it was great to be welcomed in that way. It was like a small little squad of people to meet us there. It was great. And unbelievable place, just truly beautiful. You know, we went to the Fuji Rock Fest, which is in these mountains that's like 4 hours to the west of Tokyo. And we got to see some of the countryside on the way there. And then when we were going up the mountain to get to the site where the gig was, it was just like, oh my gosh, this is beautiful. Todd saw a honey bear. You know what a honey bear is?
Yeah.
Well, I think that's what he called it. It's apparently some type of koala-type bear that's bigger than a koala. But I didn't see it, and no one else did, but Todd saw it clear as day. He's like, man, look, there's a honey bear. And we all looked but missed it, you know, because we were going, you know, 40 miles an hour or whatever, and we missed it. But it's just an incredible place.
It looked like just, like, really plush greenery and, like, foggy mountainous area.
Yeah, it's not all that different. A little bit like if you took certain parts of Colorado and mixed it with the Bay Area. You know, the low clouds that are just right on top of you, this foggy kind of thing. And it looks like smoke and stuff, but it wasn't smoke. It was just, you know, low clouds and fog and stuff. And mixed with, like, some of the most beautiful parts of Colorado that I've ever seen. It's kind of what it reminded me of.
Was that one of the few times that you've had an opportunity to play outside of the U.S.?
Yeah, it was. I mean, I'm one of those people that just, you know, I haven't been to Europe. I haven't been to Scandinavia. I haven't been to Japan until now. I haven't been, you know, to South America. I've been fishing in Central America, but I haven't played gigs. But I've played in Canada. Does that count?
I don't think Canada counts.
Canada doesn't count. Oh, darn. Poor Canada.
You'll get to add Mexico to the list pretty soon.
Yeah, that's true. Never been to Mexico either, I don't think.
Are you going to get to treat that like a vacation? You're going to get to bring the family and enjoy?
I think my wife's going to come. Yeah, I think our kids aren't coming, but I think my wife's going to come. But, you know, she knows, and she knows how I am. I mean, if we got gigs, it's not a vacation for me. I mean, playing music is not the same kind of work as construction or anything. But, I mean, you know, if I got a gig that day, I'm not going sightseeing. You know, some people can do that, but I have to keep a focus going, and I can't do that if I'm out, you know, thinking I'm on vacation. As much as I love going to see baseball games, I don't even go see baseball games, you know, on the day of a show, you know, because my energy will go into that, and then that night I'll be lacking, you know, so I can't do that. But she will have a blast. She knows me. She knows how I am. She's very tolerant. And, yeah, I mean, if I got a gig that day, the whole day revolves around that gig, you know, and it's just the only way I know how to do it.
Yeah, well, that's respectable, you know, stay focused, don't get distracted.
Yeah, because, man, after getting spoiled for so many years, having a lot of downtime and private time before the show, now, I mean, I'm so easily distracted. I mean, if I'm ready for the show, you know, and I've been alone and or just with band guys and stuff, and I've been really shedding and thinking about the gig and all that, the reason for doing that is so you don't have to think on the stage. You know, it's like by the time you get to the stage, you've already prepared yourself. And so the goal then is to not think about anything and just let yourself get out of the way and just let the music come through. But if I do that, if I prepare that way, and then I'm on the way to the stage and I have to stop and talk to someone for 15 minutes, it's all shot to hell. My focus gets really, you know, blurry after that. Not that I don't love talking to people, but if I could, I prefer to do it after the show. But, you know, so the same thing would happen to me if I went sightseeing or if I went, you know, on a boat ride or anything that pulls my focus away from the task at hand will distract me, you know. It's kind of like, I don't know if you thought about it like if you were a baseball player, you know, like, you know, you go to the park early before the game, you know, you kind of get, you do your batting practice or whatever, and then you get your mind right, you know, which is basically you prepare so you don't think when you're up playing the game. But, you know, the players don't hang out with people before the game, you know, they don't, you know, go out and go sightseeing and then go play a baseball game. You know, they got to focus, and that's kind of the way I feel about it.
Gotcha. Is it hard trying to get into that kind of mental state, like when you're doing 3, 4, 5 nights in a row?
No, it actually helps. 3, 4, 5 nights in a row helps, I think, for me.
No break, just keep it going.
You mean in the same spot, or you mean just 3 or 4 gigs straight, period?
I mean, you know, I know Panic, you know, they typically do like 3-night runs or...
I love that, man. I love that because it seems to get better with each night, you know, because the sound gets dialed in, you know, and they, you know, when you go play a place one time and you don't even get a sound check like summer festivals and things like that, you know, it always to me seems like the first part of the gig ends up being sound check. You know, like, they don't have it quite right yet. It takes, like, half the show, and then they get it dialed in. But when you're playing the same venue, like, 3 nights in a row, that's really wonderful because, you know, you do the first gig, and then they just leave everything like it was, and they remember where everything was, and then you come back to play the second gig, and it starts out good. You know, it doesn't take a few minutes for them to get it dialed in because they did it the night before. And then the same with the third night can be even better, you know.
My buddies went out to the tour ending Vegas show.
Oh, yeah.
And they were saying that was just a blast.
That was a blast. That was definitely a blast, yeah. The Joint is a real nice place now. I mean, they rebuilt it, and, well, they went to a different place. You know, they moved it to a different location, I guess. It's not in the same room anymore. It's real nice.
Right on. And I actually did a little bit of math, and it looks like it's been almost 5 years since you joined up with Panic full-time.
Yeah, that's about right. I think it was October of 06.
I've got it down to September.
Well, it might be September. It might be.
Yeah.
September, October. I knew it was in that. I don't know where our first gig was, Radio City, but I don't remember what the actual date was.
Yeah.
I know.
Sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I remember that Radio City was my first show, and we did 3 nights at Radio City.
Yeah, quite a way to kick things off.
Yeah, no pressure.
But what has your tenure with Panic been like as far as, you know, challenges, successes, memorable moments, you know, as you look back over those 5 years?
Well, the challenges, I guess, would be, you know, the big challenge is it's a huge catalog of music. And so learning the music would be one challenge, and feeling comfortable, you know, would be another challenge. Like, you know, knowing where that line is where, okay, well, you know, how much should I try to play like Mike, or should I just be myself, or should I split the difference, you know? finding that line and being comfortable there and feeling like you're doing the music justice, and at the same time tipping your hat to the man that was in that chair for all those years. You know, although it was a challenge, but a welcome challenge, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't mean it as if it was a task or something. I mean it as an honor, you know, and something.
Well, if anybody was, you know, suited enough to try to pull that off, you know, I think that was you, so.
Well, thank you, you know. I mean, I knew Mike. We were friends. We didn't, you know, hang out with each other all the time away from the road, but we talked on the road, you know. We played together. I sat in with them before, you know, and I kind of knew the kind of stuff he was into, and, you know, he had a real unique style, and so I just listened a lot to the music and tried to, you know, catch the things. I would notice from live tapes, you know, hey, when he plays that song, he plays that lick every time, so that must be a part that I'm supposed to play because it's like a recurring theme that he did. I mean, he wasn't improvising that part. He actually played that every time they played that song. So I would key in on those type of things on each song, you know, or at least try to, and, you know, pick up some of the things that I thought that he considered to be part of the song rather than just the improvisational part. And, you know, that was a challenge. And some of the successes would be just, you know, I don't know, we're still doing it. That's a success. You know, that they didn't fire me. I guess that's a success. They're my friends first. And see, that's what makes this thing so easy and fun.
Well, you know, I don't think you can go on the road with a bunch of guys and not have, you know, a solid relationship like that.
Yeah, I mean, it would be hard to. I've had to do it before, you know, especially with your heroes, because then you're like, not only do you not know them yet, but you're scared too because you respect those people so much, you know. You know, like when I first got to know Phil, you know, I was always nervous because I hope this is good enough. And same thing with Greg Allman, you know. He's been one of my idols for so long that it's like when I finally got to work with him, it was just terrifying, you know. He wasn't terrifying. He was super cool.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was your own expectations, you know, and you're hard on yourself. I mean, I think, anybody who's really diligent is their own worst critic, and, you know, you should be your own worst critic for crying out loud, you know. I mean, nobody can, you know, criticize you more than yourself, you know, if you're being honest with yourself, you know. And, you know, but playing with Panic was like, you know, getting in a bus with a bunch of friends that I've known for 18 or 20 years and just hitting the road, you know. And they were very kind to me and very, you know, like patient with me learning the material. And they were also very much like, wanted you to be yourself. Nobody wanted you to play like someone else, you know what I mean? And but then again, I've been very lucky in that department with everyone I've ever worked with. Nobody I've ever worked with wanted you to play like someone else, you know. But they were super cool, you know, and so it's easy and fun, and we have a great time. We have a great time off the stage too, you know, so, you know, it's great.
What do you think has been one of the more memorable moments that you've had with those guys?
Well, Solomon Burke sitting in with the band would be one of them. Bobby Blue Bland sitting in with the band would be one of them. As far as people sitting in, you know, it's always great when our friends sit in, you know. We've had Carl Denson, Bruce, Derek, Susan, you know, that's always fun. I don't know. I think writing music together, man, you know, would be one of the high points of my time with them, especially the last record we did. We worked with John Keen, who's somebody I've admired for a long time, and I was thrilled to be working with John Keen. And, you know, coming in and writing music together and crafting a record together, that was incredible. That was incredible. And, of course, the gigs, you know, I mean, I can't pick one, but, you know, but they're all great and they're all fun, you know.
I gotcha. As far as you kind of alluded to the learning their musical catalog.
Yeah.
And I know you've had to do that for the Grateful Dead portfolio as well as the Allman Brothers. And was any one of those more challenging than the other, or did learning the Grateful Dead and the Allman Brothers prior to the Widespread gig, you know, help that?
Oh, absolutely. Yes, because, you know, it was the same process. You know, my process is basically, okay, there's a huge catalog of music. With the Allman Brothers, I had a distinct advantage because I was a fan from the time I was, you know, very young. So I knew a lot of the songs in my head, even if I didn't know how to play them yet. And, you know, and but with the Dead, I wasn't as familiar with their music as I was with the Allman Brothers. And plus, it stylistically bounces around a lot more than the Allman Brothers do. You know, I mean, you got ragtime, you've got, you know, acid jazz, you've got ballads, folk songs, you've got, you know, just an incredible diverse amount of styles of music under the Grateful Dead catalog, you know. And so, yeah, I mean, learning the Brothers catalog, or at least some of it, you know, I didn't learn all of it, you know, but the stuff that we were playing, you know, when I was there, was tended to be from the first five albums, which was my favorite music anyway, of theirs, you know. But then with the Dead, yeah, that was an ongoing process that took years. And if I had to do it again, I'd have to start all over, you know, because it's not like riding a bike, you know. I mean, there's a lot of songs. I mean, you know, you're talking approaching 300 songs. So, you know, my process is this. I'll just listen to the music for a period of time until I feel like I know how it goes in my head, but I haven't learned to play it yet. So I'll listen to the music first, and then I'll make sort of a bar chart, you know. And what a bar chart is just an outline of the song, you know, that shows, you know, okay, the verse is 8 bars, and then it goes into the bridge, which is 4 bars, and then it goes into, you know, the chorus or whatever. And whatever it is, I make a little chart of it and fill in the chord changes. And then I don't write themes out or anything like that. I have to remember them, how to play them and where they get. But I write out where they go, you see what I mean? Like, you know, because there's so many songs, and there's so many songs that are similar to each other. And it would be real easy to get the bridge of one tune mixed up with, you know, the bridge of another tune. You might play the wrong song's bridge if you don't, you know, write it down. But then through the process of for playing it quite, you know, often, you know, you don't need the charts anymore. You know, you don't need to look at them anymore. And that process helped me immensely when it came time to learn Panic's catalog, because I had done it already a couple times with pretty big catalogs of music. So that's what I did with Panic. I just listened for like a week. I just listened to nothing but Widespread Panic and listened to live tapes, listened to the records, you know, and then made little rough outlines on pieces of paper, and then try to learn, you know, how things go before you even pick your guitar up, you know. Like, you know, I'd have the themes in my head, you know, before I even tried to pick up the guitar. So when I did pick up the guitar, it was like, oh, yeah, here it is, you know, da-da-da-da-da, you know, or whatever.
Are there any songs from the Widespread catalog, you know, whether they were ones that you helped write or ones that came prior to you joining up with them, that kind of hold some special meaning to you?
Absolutely, man. You know, I mean, I have a lot of favorite songs with Widespread because they have such a, you know, diverse, huge catalog of music, but I love the song Pilgrims. That's one of my favorites. I mean, I never get tired of it, ever, you know. I mean, it's like, man, we could play that song every night and I'd never get sick of it. It's a great song. Well, there's so many, you know, like, there's so many, like, that I love that were written long before I got there, you know. But also, the songs that have been written since I've been there, like, one of my favorites is, we don't play it very much, it's JB's ballad off the newer album called When You Coming Home. I love that tune. Let me think. Saint X is fun, you know, when we play Saint X off the new album. Let me think. The ballads. I love the ballads. You know, remember the song, remember Glory?
Oh, yeah, that's a killer song.
I love that song, yeah. And we don't play it very much, but when we do, I love the song. And then there's another one, Gradle. I love Gradle, too. But at the same time, you know, JoJo came in with that song, St. Louis, you know. That's one of the songs
that came
to get. Yeah, it's instrumental, and it's one of the songs that came along since I've been here. So I had to be there while they were crafting it and got to take part in crafting it. And so I love that one. I mean, but there's so many of them. Like, Pilgrims, I don't want to pick a favorite song, but if I had to, that might be one of them. I really like I'm Not Alone. I like Pigeons. There's so many of them, I know I'm forgetting that.
I don't know if you ever picked up on it, but I'm Not Alone seems really similar to Can't Find My Way Home.
Yeah. I can see that. Kind of similar tempo with the same similar kind of guitar riff. It's got one guitar riff, you know, where he's the chorus where he sings, "I'm not alone, I'm just blue." That part has a similar chord change in it to the main figure in "Can't Find My Way Home." Same key and everything. You know?
And unfortunately, I can't really speak to it from, you know, a musical perspective or a technical music perspective.
Just a feeling you get, huh?
Yeah, it just seems really, really similar.
Yeah, it is. It is. It might have been inspired by that song. I mean, but they wrote that so long ago, I'd have to ask them. Because I remember them playing that in 1991. You know, I remember Make Sense to Me. I remember Pigeons from when we used to open for them in 1990, you know. Yeah, they got some classics from way back when, you know.
Has there been any discussions about coming up with another album? Or
yeah.
Focus on...
We're always talking about writing. I mean, writing is a really important part of being in this group. And, yes, I mean, you know, like, I'll come up with a little riff or whatever, and if they hear me, you know, messing around with it in the dressing room or a sound check or something, they'll go, "Well, what's that?" And I'll just go, "Oh, well, it's just some riff I just came up with. Let's write a song." And, you know, like Dirty Side Down was written that way. Saint X was written that way. I forgot the name of it. Oh, yeah, Cotton Was King was written that way, too. And JoJo already had a couple of songs laying around. And at one point, visiting day, like, the way that came about was I had a baritone guitar at home, and it was a Dan Electro baritone. You know, it's tuned a fourth lower than the regular guitar, but it's not as low as a bass, you know. So it kind of falls somewhere between a guitar and a bass. And I had that riff. You know, had that little blues riff, and you know, and then JoJo heard and was like, "What's that?" You know, and then I said, "Oh, it's just this little blues riff that I came up with from playing this baritone." You know, he goes, "Man, that's cool. You know what? I got an idea. What if we took Visiting Day and like reworked it, you know, which is an old staple, an old classic Panic tune that was never put on a record." And then I was like, "Oh no, you're gonna have people throwing bottles at me from the audience. You ruined my favorite song, you know." But it was his idea to rework Visiting Day, and because all the choruses and everything stayed the same. You know, just the main riff of the song is all that changed. Like, so we took my blues riff and adapted it to the other parts of Visiting Day, and recorded it for the album.
Well,
and,
it's pretty cool when you can hear a classic song and then kind of have a new spin on it.
Yeah, I mean, it can be cool. I was just worried that, you know, people that love that song just like it was would be upset that we changed it, you know. And then I was thinking, man, this is one of the coolest riffs I ever wrote, you know. And then, you know, and then I thought, oh, it'll have this stigma attached to it. But it, you know, I guess it does to some people, but you can't worry about that. I thought his idea was brilliant, you know, like when I heard how the other parts of Visiting Day fit with that riff that I had, I was like, damn, it really is tailor-made for it. I mean, it works. And, you know, so that's what we did.
I admittedly have not heard every show from recent tours, but have y'all been playing both versions of it, or have y'all been sticking to the latest album version?
No, we haven't played the old version of it since we recorded the album, but I mean, we've talked about it, but it just hasn't happened yet. And you know, and I thought, well, yeah, why don't we do the old version of Visiting Day sometime? And everybody thought it was a good idea, but it just hadn't happened yet.
Okay. Well, I want to shift gears a little bit. As far as some of the charities that Panic's been involved with, there's Panic Fans for Food, Tunes for Tots, which is the yearly event to raise money for providing instruments to Georgia public schools.
Mm-hmm.
There's also the Panic Fans House, which is in conjunction with the Jimmy Herring Posse that's been raising money for the Make It Right Foundation.
Yeah.
And wanted to get your thoughts on those charities and then what you thought about what appears to be a significant level of fan involvement in keeping in helping support those charities.
I think it's wonderful, man. I mean, you know, Panic's always been active in charities, and they've always been really great about, you know, giving back something. And I can tell you that whole thing with the with the Tunes for Tots, I mean, geez, man, that's so important, you know, because, you know, the schools will drop music programs altogether, you know. I'm a sports fan, you know, but the football program's not going to get dropped because it brings in a lot of money. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But the music program, the orchestra, the band, the symphony or whatever, the Philharmonic and the chamber orchestras, they just don't bring in that much money. You know, that's just the bottom line. I mean, taking music out of the schools, man, I mean, you know, that's a genuine concern, you know, something to be worried about. And I think, you know, when I saw what we did for the, you know, these kids that got new band instruments, oh, my God, man, they came to the Tunes for Tots thing. You know, and I saw a videotape, and I got to meet some of the kids. Man, I got a new saxophone because of you guys, you know, that kind of stuff. Man, that was huge, you know. That's huge because it's a known fact that music, kids who get involved with music, you know, it's good for their brain. You know, they read more. They think more. You know what I mean? They're less likely to get in trouble. You know what I mean? Things like that. And it's just really important, man, you know? I mean, sports are important, too. I'm a huge sports fan. And I think, but I think music's just as important, you know? Although, you know, that's why we did that. It's a wonderful thing. And then the other thing, of course, you know, with the building a house in New Orleans, I mean, man, I'm so proud to be connected with an organization that gives back, you know, and even more incredible is the fans are building a house, you know. I mean, how cool is that, you know, when your fans go, oh, wow, you know, you guys are building a house for someone in New Orleans. Well, we're going to do it too, you know. That it doesn't get any better than that. I mean, that is just incredible, and I'm truly honored to be part of it, you know.
I do, and I know this next Tunes for Tots event is going to be possibly even more impressive than the last, you know, with it being at the theater this year.
Mm-hmm. I'm excited. Yeah.
There's going to be a lot of fans that are going to be trying to get into there.
Yeah, just like some of them probably did in the old days, you know, sneak in through the back door or whatever.
I haven't found the secret entrance yet.
No, neither have I. One thing I noticed is that they have a really nice dressing room and stuff, but it's like five flights of stairs to get up to it. And, you know, like when we finished our show the other night with Bruce, my hands were all clammy, and all I needed to do was just wash my hands real quick. But it took me so long to get up the stairs to get to get to the bathroom and then get back down there. Bruce panicked and started the encore without us. did you notice that?
I noticed that. I was like, what's going on?
Me and O'Teal had to take a leak and I had to wash my hands. Okay. Bruce panics and starts the show without us. I mean, that was just hilarious. It wasn't really a panic. I say panic, I'm just kidding around. But that's so typical of him. He would do that in the old days too. Like if you weren't there, he didn't care. He would just start the show without you. Of course, this was just the encore, but we came running. But the elevator was broken, at the Georgia Theater. So normally there's an elevator there that'll take you up to the dressing room real super fast, and get you there and get you back down real quick. But we had to climb those stairs and come back down them, so it took a minute.
Well, fortunately, Bruce can hold his own up there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he doesn't need us. He was fine. He was doing it. He's up there doing it.
He can do some comedy and do a few tunes as well. But, that was all the questions.
See you fixing with that. Yeah.